Thank you. Happy Easter, friends. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Welcome to our Easter worship service here at UPC this beautiful Seattle Sunday morning. What a glorious day all the way around, isn't it? You are welcome to jump into the chat and greet one another. And you know what? I will post moments throughout the chat early in the service so you can invite a friend to worship with us online from anywhere in the world. And so from wherever you are worshiping today, please do greet one another. Tell us where you're worshiping from, and I'll be posting a connect card too. And if you could just let us know, share a word or two with us, that would be fantastic. So you can invite a friend, and we will worship together, and we have an amazing worship service where we celebrate this day from last Holy Week to today. So with that, let's quiet our hearts and open them up with so much joy and join our friends in the sanctuary.
Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Amen. That's what one group of eyewitnesses said to another group of eyewitnesses that first Easter Sunday many, many years ago, but we celebrate him today, and I want to welcome you here for Easter at University Presbyterian Church. My name is George Hinman, and I'm so glad to be with you, whether you're here by radio or online or especially in the room. You all got up early this morning, and it is great to see your faces. Thanks for being here. Here at UPC, our mission is to join Jesus to transform our lives and the lives of our neighbors. What a great day this is to participate in the ministry of Jesus. If you're new here or if you're visiting, we want to give you a special welcome. Those of you who might actually be neighbors who came, thanks for coming. Maybe somebody shared a link with you or a little card or invited you to be here today. We're so glad that you took the risk to come and celebrate Jesus with us today. I know that coming to a church can be a strange or scary place, particularly when you don't know the church, but you're willing to do that. And I want you to know, no matter where you are on your faith journey, we know that God is faithful to you, and we consider you a part of our family here at University Presbyterian Church. We want you to feel safe and at home here. We're going to sing a couple of songs today. We're going to say a few prayers. We're going to read the Bible together, and I just want to invite you to find your own way of joining the celebration as we gather around Him, our risen Savior, today.
I'd like to invite us to all stand together and sing "When I Turn Around and Cue You, Crown Him with Many Crowns."
morning, UPC. My name is Anna Carlson, and I work with middle schoolers and high schoolers here at our church. Now we're going to go into a time of confession, where we acknowledge to God where we have fallen short, where we have messed up, and ask for his forgiveness. Please join me in prayer. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. And now, hear these words of assurance written by Paul the Apostle. Who can accuse the people God has chosen? No one, because God is the one who makes them right. Who can say God's people are guilty? No one, because Jesus Christ died, but he was also raised from the dead, and now he is on God's right side, appealing to God for us. In Christ we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Amen. I'd like to invite us to stand once more for this and a couple of elements that follow it. We're going to sing now together, Christ the Lord is risen today.
My name's Miko, and I'm going to lead us in the Apostles' Creed, which provides us with a summary of the Christian faith and connects us with believers all over the world. Christian, what do you believe?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
In a moment, I want to invite any kids who are here with us right now. First of all, wave at me, and now wave at Jill, and come on down as we sing. We've got a very special moment for you. Let's sing the doxology together. Please be seated.
Hey, everyone, and welcome to Imani's Kitchen. I'm so glad to have you join us today. I'm joined by Chef Kyla in purple, and in blue, I have Chef Joshua. Let's help share the Easter story with our friends. Let's have a bake-off competition.
What better thing to do than that?
But how can baking help us realize the true meaning of Easter miracle?
Today, we are going to be making resurrection cookies. Let's see how creative both of you can be with this recipe.
This represents when Jesus was arrested and beaten by the Roman soldiers.
John 19, verses 1 to 2 says, "Then Pilate took Jesus and had him whipped. The soldiers twisted thorns together to make a crown. They put it on Jesus' head."
Ugh. I read in John 19 that Jesus was given vinegar when he said he was thirsty on the cross.
John 19, 28, verse 30 says, "Later Jesus knew that everything had now been finished. He also knew that what scripture said must come true. So he said, 'I am thirsty.' A jar of wine vinegar was there. So they soaked a sponge in it. They put the sponge on the stem of a hyssop plant and they lifted it up to Jesus' lips. After Jesus drank, he said, 'It is finished.' Then he bowed his head and died."
Jesus gave his life so that we can be a part of his family.
That's right. And in this recipe, eggs represent life.
John chapter 10, verse 10 says, "I have come so they may have life. I want them to have it in the fullest way possible."
The salt represents the salty tears shed by Jesus' friends and the sadness of our own wrong choices called sin.
The sweetest part of Easter is that Jesus died because he loves us and took the punishment for our wrong choices once and for all. Let's add 1 cup of sugar.
John 3:16 says, "God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son. Anyone who believes in him will not die, but will have eternal life."
This reminds me of Jesus' tomb. Each mound represents the rocky tomb where Jesus' body was laid.
Yeah, you're right. I think these cookies do look like a mound. I think they're ready to go into the oven. How about we put them in?
Yeah.
Let's take the oven shut, just like Jesus' tomb was sealed.
Jesus' followers were really sad when the tomb was sealed with a rock, not tape. They had to leave Jesus' body there.
That is sad. But be patient and have faith, because the Easter miracle is about to happen.
Yay.
Yay. I'm so excited to see if our cookies are ready yet.
These look good.
I know.
Whoa.
Taste and see that the Lord is good.
Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh, Joshua, that was so awesome. You know what? Kala can't be here. You know, she's a Michelin star chef, and she's at another bake off competition. So that's okay, though. But I tasted her cookie, and it was so good. I cannot wait to try yours.
Yeah.
Thanks. Oh, it looks so good. Oh my goodness. Look at these kids. So good. The pecans taste good. So sweet. You're a great chef. Great chef.
Thank you, Damani. Did you know that on the first Easter, Jesus' friends were amazed to find the tomb open and empty?
Wow. That is amazing.
Matthew 28, verse 5 to 6 says, "The angels said to the women, 'Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified and died. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said he would.'"
You know what? That's really good news, kids. You know, Jesus is alive. You know, many years ago, Jesus' friends, they went and checked the tomb, and he wasn't there. The tomb was open. It wasn't there, and he was not there. He's alive, and he's risen. And that is something that we can celebrate. Isn't that right?
Yes, it is. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for helping us. Thank you for protecting us through these days. We are so thankful that you are our friend and that you care for us every day. In Jesus' name we pray and believe. Amen.
You know what, kids? Before you go back and sit down, after the service, if you look straight in the back, you'll see a table that has a white tablecloth, and it says Imani's Kitchen, and you'll have a chance to come and try these cookies that our chefs prepared. And you know what? They're nut free, so all of you can try them. Thanks for joining us.
I want one of those cookies. All right, so one of the things that we do as a church family is pray for one another. So please join me in prayers of the people. God, thank you that we get to gather today and celebrate Jesus' resurrection from the dead. This event, this amazing event, has changed the trajectory of our lives. Your love, shown to us through Jesus' life, death, and then rising from the dead, is so wonderful that just as the springtime brings new life in the trees and flowers through the U District, so you imbue us with new life. Lord, we now bear and lift up one another's burdens, as you have taught us. We cast our cares upon you, for you care for us. While we get the honor here today of celebrating your life, there are still places where death hangs heavy, where sadness and sin and grief seem to reign. Lord, we pray for people living in the midst of war or under the bonds of oppression. Please, Lord, bring them your miraculous peace. We also pray for those who are sick, for those who are in need of healing. Lord, please heal them and bring into their bodies new life. We pray for our neighbors here in the U District, for the students who are a couple of weeks into the spring quarter, that you would walk with them. Lord, for our neighbors who don't have a roof over their head at night, that you would provide for them. Lord, and for those who don't know you yet, that they would see you. God, please show yourself to us. Come alongside us and bring us into your love. God, please do not let us walk away from this service unchanged, but by your Holy Spirit, give us new life flowing in our veins.
We pray that with Mary Magdalene, we would say, I have seen the Lord. We now pray together using the words your Son, Jesus Christ, has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We continue our worship of Jesus through the giving of our gifts and offerings. As we wonder how we might respond to the ultimate gift of God, let me encourage you along these lines. Our financial offerings today are a part of how we can join Jesus in his mission through this church, ministry to our neighbors at the University of Washington, in Seattle, and throughout the world. We will be passing an offering plate in our rows today, so thank you, ushers, for coming forward. If you've brought an offering, you can leave it in the plate as it's passed, or you can give at upc.org/give. The scriptures say, each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Let's pray for God's blessing on our offering. Thank you, God, for your blessings in our lives. Please use this offering for your purposes, that in every way it is used, it would be used for your glory. Thank you for these offerings, for your blessings, and thank you that we get to participate in what you are doing at UPC in this way. In your name we pray, amen.
Thank you.
We come to you now. We come. At your invitation, we come. You are the darling of heaven and God's dear son. And yet you have come to us to carry our burden. Oh, we are weary and heavy laden. And so we must come to you. We are thirsty and you are the living water. We are hungry and you are the bread of life. We come now to hear and pray through your word and spirit to meet you, the word made flesh. So would you speak? Your servants are listening. In Christ's name, amen. Well, our Easter scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of St. John, one of the very first eyewitnesses to the risen Savior Jesus Christ. And I would invite you to turn there to John 20, verses 11 through 18. I'd invite you, if you're able, to stand with me and to read the scripture aloud. You'll find it printed in the program. You'll find it printed on the screens. If you'd like, the Pew Bible, it's on page 882, John 20, verses 1 through 18. And when we're done reading, I'll say, "This is the word of the Lord," so that if you believe it, you can say, "Thanks be to God." Listen carefully. You're reading God's holy word. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been laying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. This is the word of the Lord. The grass withers and the flower falls, but the word of the Lord lasts forever. Please be seated. Well, I really like this resurrection account. This resurrection account is, I would say, a lost Jesus story. You may have heard of Jesus' famous lost son story. He once was lost, but then he's found. But this is a lost Jesus story, almost as though they've misplaced him. Mom, Dad, anyone know where Jesus is? Oh, no, have we lost him again? Did you check the garage? Mary gets there first. Peter and John are clueless. The two guys in white suits are no help. The gardener seems like a nice guy, a little familiar, but just not helpful. Mary, she apparently turns around and looks Jesus right in the face, but doesn't recognize him. Just plain lost him. I like this resurrection story because sometimes I lose Jesus too. Do you know what I mean? We lose him in the church. We lose him in our family. We lose him in the thing that we're going through right now because it's just so cool and awesome. I don't really need Jesus and let him sit in the sock drawer a little bit too long. Or because it's so messed up and hard, I just don't have any time for a guy with sandals and linen. Sometimes I lose Jesus in my own life. Do you ever lose him? Maybe you had him when you were younger, but then you misplaced him in college. Maybe you had him in the marriage, but then you lost him in the divorce. Maybe you have a parent or friend who keeps saying, "Here he is," But as much as you try, you can't seem to find him. Where have they put him? Mary Magdalene asks. And yet he's right there, speaking to her. Suddenly she realizes it and she cries out, I have seen the Lord. I like that. I wonder if that suggests that there's a way that Jesus is with us, but we just can't see him. Reminds me of another story. Jacob wrestling with God. Even Jacob could lose God. These last few weeks we've been talking about Jacob's great wrestling match. Jacob is also face to face with God, but he can't see it. Even Jacob could lose God. We find Jacob in Genesis chapter 32. He's wrestling through the night with a shadowy figure, striving, struggling. He's in crisis. He's tried to do everything he knows how to do. He's even tried prayer. And when he most needs God, it seems at first all he gets is a man. But Jacob wrestles with a man. The man wounds him in the hip. Jacob keeps struggling. He refuses to let the man go without a blessing. That night, the Lord changes Jacob's name to Israel. It means the one who struggles with God. This is an iconic moment for the nation. And the people that would descend from Jacob and bear his name, Israel. It says something about the nature of faith, Israel, the struggle, that it wouldn't be easy, that it'll be a struggle to find God, a struggle with doubt, a struggle to believe, a struggle to trust, a struggle to obey. Israel will be the people who struggle with God and yet who somehow receive a blessing. I see a lot of similarities here between Jacob and Mary Magdalene. Both struggle in the shadow of death. Both cling to a mysterious figure in the dark. Both are asked in the dawn to let go. Both are named. Both are the first of a new people. And both come to understand that they have, in fact, seen the Lord. For Jacob, like Mary, exclaims in the morning, I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved. Jacob couldn't see the Lord at first, but he was right there in his own arms. And again, we learn the Lord is with us, even when we can't see him. Mary doesn't want to lose Jesus again, does she? Do you get the sense that maybe that's why she's locked her arms around him? She must have been a remarkable person, Mary Magdalene. All four Easter accounts, Mary is the first one to see Jesus risen from the dead. They all note that. Now, it could have been a Jacob. Two of the 12 disciples were named Jacob, Israel, or James, as the name is translated. But no, it was Mary, not Jacob, who sees him alive first. It's important that Jesus chose to make himself known to a woman first. At a time when women weren't even allowed to testify in court, Jesus says to Mary, I want you to testify to me. You'd never make something like that up. And I love that about Jesus. Mary Magdalene. Later to be called the apostle to the apostles, first to see him rise, first to proclaim the good news, always listed first with other women, a woman of means who followed Jesus from the early days and supported his ministry out of her own generosity. Some say she was a prostitute or a lover. The Bible doesn't teach that. Jesus did save prostitutes. Mary Magdalene wasn't one of them. There's a whole lot we don't know about this Mary, but here's the thing we do know. She knew what it was to struggle. Luke tells us she had had seven demons in her life. Seven. That's the Bible's number for totality. Jesus tells us you can sweep one unclean spirit out of your life, but it might travel the waterless regions and come back with seven more. And that was Mary. Miserable, imprisoned, helpless. Today we might imagine chronic addiction, howling depression, paralyzing anxiety. For Mary, life itself had become a struggle, just living. And that was her struggle. Seven demons. 7 voices in her life, telling her lies, troubling her spirit, taking her down dark paths. And then one day, there's another voice, clear and true, a voice that calls her out of the darkness, a voice that sends all the other voices to hell, Mary. It was the voice of Jesus. Mary. Jesus, inside her struggle, saying, Mary, I'm with you, even when you can't see me. You see, you and I have a tendency to get lost ourselves. There's a phrase in the old prayer books for that. The phrase is miserable offenders. Miserable offenders refers to the awful tendency in life to lose our own lives, to lose ourselves. The prayer is the phrase comes in a prayer of confession of our own lostness. It goes like this: O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Anne and I prayed that old 1662 Book of Common Prayer with students in Cambridge this fall on our sabbatical, morning and evening, including the phrase miserable offenders. Somehow it became a gift to say it, to tell the truth about ourselves, a relief to know that by ourselves we are hopelessly and helplessly lost. We're miserable offenders. Now, I know we don't think that way anymore as modern people, do we? We don't use that kind of language for ourselves. We're not offenders, are we? Who is there to offend? See, somewhere along the way we lost God. And we don't feel miserable, do we? Aren't we all good? See, somewhere along the way we lost ourselves. But the prayer book is not talking about how you think or how you feel. It's old language. Here, miserable is not an emotion, meaning how you feel. It's a condition, meaning an object of pity. A condition. C.S. Lewis gives an illustration of how you can be an object of pity without feeling miserable at all. He says, imagine 2 trains, that you have a bird's eye view of 2 commuter rails speeding towards one another at 60 miles an hour on the same track. And from above, you can see that they'll collide in 40 seconds. You can plainly see, therefore, that the people on those 2 trains are objects of pity, and yet they joke and read the news, certainly not feeling miserable. You see, sometimes we can't even see ourselves very clearly. But the old prayer book knows that those who see themselves as miserable offenders are those who can receive mercy. And Lewis adds that the people who find a way to talk about their own sin stop talking about the sin of others. We have a tendency to get lost. This is why Mary Magdalene is so famous. We're all Mary Magdalene, aren't we? But those who admit that they are what she was can become what she becomes. Because Jesus promises, I'm with you even when you can't see me. Which brings us most importantly to the gardener. Yeah, the gardener. See, Jesus was lost so that we can be found. She thinks he's the gardener. And they buried him in a garden, in the tomb of a dignitary and secret disciple named Joseph of Arimathea. So it is a garden. And it's the dark of dawn, and Jesus slips up from behind, okay. But she doesn't recognize him. She can't see him as the one who was crucified. She thinks he's the gardener. And it seems to me almost like Jesus kind of plays along. I wonder if he picks up a rake and leans against it. Woman, he asks, why are you weeping? Just repeating what the angels had said. Woman, whom are you looking for? He says. Well, he knows very well whom, but he wants her to think about who he is. Maybe he draws the rake coyly through a few leaves. She's not right about the gardener thing, is she? She's not. But she's not wrong either. She's not wrong. Not according to the one who's writing this account, who was also there that morning and who saw these same things with his own eyes. The word that St. John uses here For gardener is the word that Ezekiel, the prophet, hundreds of years earlier would use for the Garden of Eden. This kind of a gardener. Ezekiel says this, so the Lord through him, thus says the Lord God, on the day that I cleanse you from all your iniquities, they will say, this land that was desolate has become like the Garden of Eden. This is the garden of this gardener. Here's the promise that one day the Lord would restore the beauty of Eden, that he would forgive our sin, and that he would renew all of creation in another garden. Who is this gardener? He's the keeper and redeemer of creation. He has sown his own body dead into the earth to destroy death. And he has risen an imperishable tree of life to make creation fruitful. He rises with a flower like the glory of the sun and the moon and the stars. He rises with the healing of the nation in his leaves. Here is the new Adam speaking to the new Eve, woman. Here is the elder brother speaking of a new spiritual family. My father and your father. My God and your God. Here is the giver of life speaking to his followers of the heavenly power he will blow into their nostrils. It's better for you that I go away and ascend to the Father. Receive the Holy Spirit. You see, St. John is writing a creation account. That's why he begins the same way Genesis begins, in the beginning. In the beginning, God created. That's Genesis 1:1. In the beginning was the Word. That's John 1:1. For John, the resurrection is the beginning of a whole new creation, a new order of being, a new humanity, a new life that lasts forever, new creation. Who is this gardener? Gardener is God. He made the garden, and it was good. But something bad happened. Miserable offenders. The lies of a demon poisoned the garden, and its fruit became bad, its trees barren, and a long winter settled in. And the curse of death lay upon its waterless regions. The good garden had become bad, and it is getting worse. I mean, there is a train coming. But the gardener, as it happens, the gardener loves this garden very much. And he loves the offenders within it. Each and every one of them. But what can he do? He can't look at what is not good and say it is good, so what can he do? Well, he does what gardeners do. God enters the garden himself to make it right, to tend and sow and prune. He puts on flesh and blood. He puts on muckers and coveralls. He ruptures the time-space continuum and comes to be with us as one of us. And this gardener, he didn't come and curse the tree. He didn't come and chop it down. He didn't pull the weeds, destroying the wheat and the tares. No, what he did was let the garden curse him. He let the miserable offenders nail him to one of its desiccated trees, the tree of the confusion of good and evil, a human sacrifice, an offering to the demons that hold us captive. And the gardener died, and he really was lost. We lost him. The Father lost him. The garden lost him. And the demons rejoiced, and Mary Magdalene wept. But on the third day, the people went about their toil and struggle, but on the third day. Principalities and powers darkened the garden, but on the third day. Weeds and thistles were still growing, but on the third day, just as one demon raised a glass to another, someone in old Joseph's garden leaned on a rake and said, "Mary." And Mary Magdalene fell before the maker and giver of life, grabbed his boots, and said, "I have seen the Lord." See, he was lost so that we can be found. And what that means for you and for me is that the Lord is with us even when we can't see him. He is. And no matter what your struggle is today, you may not be able to see him the way Jacob or Mary did, but you can know he's right there in the middle of it, ready to give you a blessing. And it means that no matter how often you think you've lost him, he will never, never, never lose you. He is risen. Are we so Presbyterian this morning? We can do better. He is risen.
He is risen.
All right. Would you please bow your head and pray with me? Friends, I know it's odd to speak to someone you can't see, but Jesus is here right now, alive. He can see you. He can hear you. He knows your thoughts before you do. And he wants you to find him. The Bible says God has determined the time and place of our lives so that we would search for God and perhaps grope for him and find him, though indeed he is not far from each one of us. The Bible says that. He's trying to help us to find him as we grope and struggle and wrestle. And that's why we're here. I believe Jesus has two invitations for us this morning. One for those of us coming to Jesus for the first time, and one for those coming back to Jesus. Mary Magdalene experienced both. What about you? Maybe today Jesus is inviting you to come back to him, like Mary Magdalene here in the garden. He's your Lord and Savior, but somewhere along the way you lost him, and you're ready to come back. Back to your first love. He's been walking unseen at your side, and it's time for you to start walking with him again. If you'd like to come back to Jesus this morning, would you please raise your hand? Just take a moment. We're going to keep our heads bowed. Jesus will see. I will see. No one else will see. But it's a way of responding physically the way Mary did when she turned around. Yes, thank you. I see that. Would you indicate physically with your body to Jesus that it's time for you to turn around and walk with him as again. If you'd like to come back to Jesus, yes, thank you. Raise your hand. Good. God, he sees that. He honors that. Maybe today Jesus is inviting you to come to him for the first time. Like Mary Magdalene, when Jesus first met her and healed her. Jesus in John 5 says, "Very truly I tell you, anyone who hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and does not come under judgment, but is passed from death to life." That could be you today. You hear his word. Maybe you believe his promise, and that's enough. It's not about trying a little harder. It's not about becoming a better person. It's about admitting that you cannot save yourself and letting Jesus be your Savior. It's not about emotion, feeling miserable or sentimental. It's about hearing the promise and trusting it, trusting him. It's about letting him bear the eternal consequences of your own offense, letting him enter the darkness that holds you captive. The Bible says he has borne our infirmities. He was wounded for our transgressions. Upon him was laid the punishment that made us whole. By his bruises, we are healed. Jesus says, anyone who hears my word and believes does not come under judgment, but is passed from death to life. That's your own resurrection. And it can happen spiritually right here, right now, on Easter morning. If you'd like to come to Jesus for the first time, would you please raise your hand? Tell him you want to say yes. Do you want to receive what he has come to give you? Perhaps what he brought you here to receive. What you're saying to him is, Jesus, there's a lot I don't know. I have a struggle, the struggle of faith. But I offer you all that I know of myself to all that I know of you. If you'd like to say yes to Jesus for the first time this morning, would you please raise your hand? Let's use the old words together, shall we? Oh Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Thank you for your great mercy. Thank you for setting the captives free. Thank you for opening the eyes of faith. Thank you for the cross that takes away the guilt of our sin, that we are saved by grace through faith and not our own works. Thank you for the empty tomb, that we were dead, but now we live, that we were lost, but now we're found. Thank you for the Holy Spirit who comes upon all who believe with a new birth into a new family, that we might say to one another, my sister, my brother, and to you, my Father and my God. Grant us, O Lord, the blessing of Jacob and Mary in all our struggles this day and evermore. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. We do have one request for you today, and that is that you would let us know that you're here. In fact, I'd like everybody to pull out a smartphone. Take out your phone for just a second. Reach into your pocket, your purse, grab a phone, and please navigate over to upc.org/connect. Or take a shot of this QR code. I would love everybody to do this today. It would really help us. We're trying to get a baseline on Easter of our extended family here at UPC. You just give us your name. Fill out the form that pops up. Just give us your name. You can give us any other information that you want, but we'd love to have your name and the name of anybody else who's there with you. You could put a prayer request or let us know how we can serve you. There, that would be helpful. Now, I just want to add, if you did raise your hand this morning to say yes to Jesus for the first time, then I'd really like you to check the box that says yes to Jesus. Anybody today who checks the box yes to Jesus, I'm going to send you a few short books that will help you grow in your new relationship with God. So for that, please do provide a mailing address so I can send you those books. And then on your phone, click submit the bottom button. Or if you don't have a smartphone with you, we do have cards in the pew rack there. So would you pull out those cards and just pass them around? If you see somebody who doesn't have a phone, just make sure they get one of those cards and a pencil. And you could take those cards and put them in a blue box at the door as you make your way out this morning. Thank you.
Friends, if you're willing and able, let's stand now and sing and continue to worship.
Can all come Together. In the dark.
Hey, let's say thank you to our worship teams, the choir and the band today, and everybody who helped to put this on. Thank you for those of you who are serving and volunteering. And thank you for being here to worship and celebrate Jesus with us today. It's a gift to be with you, to see your face. What a great occasion it is today. If you would like to come to say yes to Jesus, don't forget upc.org/connect. Fill out the connect card, check the yes to Jesus box, and we will follow up with you, help you get to know him better. You can take the connect cards, the paper ones, and put them in the blue box. I can even see it right here in the back. Hey, I want to invite you to come back next week. We began a conversation today, and we're going to continue it. We designed a new sermon series. It's very accessible to the beginner, called Who is Jesus? Who is Jesus? We're going to take 6 weeks, talk about who is Jesus, and how do we find him in our own lives. So a good series to come back for next Sunday, to invite a friend maybe to join you with that. Our regular service times, note this, they're not the same as what we have today. It's 8:30 a.m. and 10:45 a.m., same with the live streams. But we got to get out of this room because we know that we've got another group of people who want to come in. So grab someone near you, introduce yourself to them, and invite them to go with you upstairs and then to the right into the room where we've got some treats, some refreshments, and an opportunity to meet some more people. All right, the charge this week. The charge this week is to take a step of faith, to step into that which is unseen on the basis of God's promise. To find and follow Jesus through the struggle that you're in right now. Your struggle and maybe the struggle of a neighbor as well. Remember, Jesus sent Mary to tell others, let's do the same. This news is so good, it's too good to keep to ourselves. And as we go, let's go with a benediction, with a blessing from heaven. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. And all God's people said, amen.
Thank you, friends, for worshiping together today. What an awesome day it is. A powerful sermon. And if you want to hear it again or see that amazing Chef Imani video, stay tuned and come back at 9:30 because you can see it all over again. As Pastor George said, we start a new series next week, and it's called Who is Jesus? And even if you think you know who Jesus is, it's never, never too late or bad to get a refresher. So I hope that you'll come back next Sunday. In the meantime, if you have any prayer needs or requests throughout the week, you can email us at prayer@upc.org. And so with that, bless you. I hope you get strawberries, lemon bars, and a cream puff, because that's what the folks in Geneva are having this morning. So happy Easter, and he is risen. He's risen indeed. See you next Sunday.